Recorded Books and RB Digital present Like Vanessa by Tami Charles, narrated by Channie Waits. September 17th, 1983. America. All them lights bathing her white, washing away the slightest trace. Miss America, they call her. Smile so bright, eyes shut tight, brand new day. Everybody talking about history'll be made, we'll win the race. Really, I say, 'cause if it were me, would they feel the same way? In the land of the free, home of the brave, we'll bust up that long shut door. Course, it'll be a light and bright, two shades from white. Least, America ain't the America we know from before. Dear Darlene, Miss America's coming on tonight. You ready? Nessie. 50 stinking years. Pop-Pop gave me my very first Darlene 8 years ago and a brand new one every year after that, custom made of pressed, dried wildflowers spanning every color of the rainbow. Most kids my age would call Darlene a diary, but she's much more than a place to write stupid lists of the cutest guys in eighth grade. Darlene's my chill spot, a place to share the lyrics in my head, the words crawling through my bones, the latest gossip running through Grafton Hill. Today's hot topic? Miss America. Pop-Pop and I got a bet going for this year. Miss America's never crowned a black girl, ever. And that pageant's been going on every year since 1933. Way I see it, the powers that be have no plans whatsoever to pick a girl who looks like me. Let Pop-Pop tell you, everything's gonna change this year. Watching Miss America is our little tradition. Each of us eyeing the screen, clutching onto a memory long gone. His memory is of a time with his daughter, my mother, honey-eyed, vanilla-coated, lullaby-singing angel. Him pretending that on this very day every year, he could have a piece of his little girl back through me. And me watching alongside Pop-Pop. My memory, pushing, hoping, forcing myself to remember her. To remember what having a mother feels like. To even for a second drown myself in her beauty, even though I don't look a thing like her. I pull out the hot comb, pomade, and all my favorite hair bows. Pop-Pop lets me straighten and braid his hair while he nurses a coffee cup of whiskey. Me pretending I'm the one getting my hair done and Mama's doing it. Pop-Pop pretending the whiskey's a cure-all. A magic potion in all its bittersweetness helping him remember too. The hot comb glides through with ease. My grandfather has some silky, long, curly hair. Says he gets it from his Cherokee side. That Cherokee blood must have skipped over me. Halfway through the show, two black women make it to the top 10. Miss New York, Vanessa Williams, and Miss New Jersey, Suzette Charles. They're both so beautiful, black, the light-skinned and curly hair type like Pop-Pop and Mama. Maybe they got some Cherokee in them, too. This is it, Nessie, Pop-Pop says before they start to announce the top five. This year is our year. Get on in here, TJ. We about to make history. My cousin TJ comes running into the living room, feather boa in one hand, pen and sketch pad in the other. He wraps the boa around my neck saying, here you go, Miss America. Then he plops down on the couch and starts drawing pageant gowns like mad. On the fuzzy black and white screen, Gary Collins starts announcing the runners up. And just as Pop-Pop predicts, this is the year black women make history at the Miss America pageant. Because not one, but two of us are standing there waiting to be announced as the new winner. My fists clench with the strength of an army 10,000 strong, hopes flying sky high, anxiety drowning in my chest. Would the Miss America pageant even let a black girl win? Give girls like me the tiniest piece of hope that yes, black is beautiful? Even if it means that they'd start with the light and bright, two shades from white kind? Because if so, then that means that one day girls like me, the darkest of black, could be seen as pretty too. Suzette Charles takes the first runner-up spot. And at this point, I'm thinking, okay, we came close enough. We ain't gonna see a day like this for probably another 50 years.
And your new Miss America is...
Vanessa Williams! Gary Collins shouts into the microphone, and I swear, I just about lose my mind. The spotlights lower onto Vanessa's bad-to-the-bone silver and white one-shouldered gown. The audience thunders with applause. After the crown is placed on her head, she takes her ceremonial walk down the runway. And she's working it, too. Hips swaying, teeth all shining, and she's got that Miss America wave down pat. I stare at the screen. Stare real long and hard. Vanessa Williams' face fades away and Mama sets in. I mean, really, they could be twins. It's like Mama can see me through that television, right through me. And the way she's looking is like she's making a promise. She'll come back someday, when things are right, when all the broken pieces are mended back together. We'll go back to the time when we were us, the Martins, minus the booze, minus the stares, minus the whispers. These days, you might as well call us the left behinds. We're the ones that were left behind the day Mama walked out all those years ago. That was when everything changed. The rest of the family forgot about us. Pop-Pop turned to booze, Daddy's spirit up and died, and we moved to the projects of Grafton Hill. Daddy walked into that empty bedroom, his soul black as night, and locked his door. And I ain't seen the inside of that room or his heart ever since. Only comes out to go to work, which can be any time, day or night. Things will get better. Mama's voice whispers through the television, sweet like honeydew in summer. A shiver courses through the arch of my back. I'm soaking in Mama, well, Vanessa, through that screen as if she sees me, the real me. It's like I know I gotta do something to make everything right. For everybody, all I gotta do is find Mama. But how? I'm sitting on our brown shag carpet, boo-hooing like a dang fool, clutching onto Darlene's shoulders, shaking worse than an earthquake. My prayers turn to words that I hold on to, fighting to remember so me and Darlene can talk about it later. Next thing I know, I'm up off that floor, wiping away my tears, jumping up and down and clapping my hands. I'm clapping for Vanessa, clapping for Mama, clapping for me. All the years I've watched this pageant, and not once did I see a black girl win. Nobody ever did, not before tonight. I know I'm never gonna forget this. I start prancing around the room, doing the Miss America wave, close my eyes real tight like, picture that Miss America crown on Mama's head. Picture it on mine, too. Picture Daddy smiling again, wrapping his big, old, earthy hands around Mama's tiny little waist like he used to do. Pop-Pop pulls me close to his chest, his liquor-laden scent stinging my nose. That's gonna be you one day, Nessie. Your singing is just as good as Vanessa Williams, and Miss America's even got the same name as you. It's meant to be, baby girl. Yeah, and when you do make it to Miss America, you already know who's doing all your styling. I won't even charge you full price, TJ jokes. And in that moment, I believe what they say could be true for me. That I could be like Vanessa Williams. Long as it doesn't take no 50 stinking years, because I'm not sure me and Mama got that kind of time on our hands. September 19th, 1983. Unpretty. The world ain't so pretty if there are no flowers, no seeds to bear, no sun to cast out the darkness, no soil to fill it with promises to remind us that like wings, hope can take flight, even among all things unpretty. Dear Darlene, I love that part in The Bluest Eye that talks about the soil being bad for certain types of flowers. Pecola thinks that's why the seeds won't grow in her town among the garbage. That maybe it's just too late. You think Toni Morrison's ever been to Newark? 'Cause there ain't nothing but garbage here, too. Garbage on the streets, and those needles the dope heads drop in the alleys, and the elevators that carry me to the 8th floor of my apartment in Grafton Hill. Except there ain't no flowers in my hood. Just that fake plastic general store-looking sunflower Pop-Pop puts on the windowsill, trying to pretend like our crib is some penthouse out in Beverly Hills. But everybody knows you can cover up caca with perfume, but after a while, it's still gonna stink. Nessie. Not even Daddy calls me that. It's six period chorus, and as usual, I'm not the only one ignoring the teacher. The scattered noises of gossip and hip-hop rhymes battle it out against the melody Mrs. Walton's playing on the piano. Eighth graders, 35. Mrs. Walton, 0. My seat is in the back of our dungeon-like music room, behind the chaos, behind Tanisha, who's lost herself in her sketchpad. I sink into my chair, placing the bluest eye on top of Darlene, and reach for my next read, I Know Why the Cage Bird Sings. Pop-Pop says he got it special for me because I'm his little songbird. I turn to the first page, ready to lose myself in the words, ready to pretend I'm anywhere but here. Mrs. Walton stops playing the piano, and suddenly I feel a pair of icy eyes hawking me. Vanessa Martin, school's been in session for 3 weeks now. You think you want to join us sometime soon? Tension tiptoes up my spine. I sit up straight like I've been listening all along, which is a bald-faced lie. But of all the people in the room, she chooses to call on me. Everyone turns and looks at me like, what you gonna do now? Even Tanisha staring me down, begging me to say something, anything. My lips turn to salt and start to quiver at the thought of being stared at, because even 1 second of attention is a second too long. Everybody's got their rep in eighth grade. Mine? I'm like oxygen. You know I'm there, but you don't see me. I shut my mouth. I make good grades. And when the bell rings at the end of the day, I take my butt home, close my door, and dream of a place far, far away from here. Guidance made me take this class. Singing just ain't my thing. My voice is a loud whisper. It's enough to produce a few oohs. And once that starts, I know the teacher will have a point to prove. Mrs. Walton slowly struts to my desk. The click-clacking of her heels echoes through the room. Her tiny frame grows larger as she walks toward me, looking like she's ready to start something. She's new to King Middle, probably never taught a single black kid in her life. And like most white teachers they send here, she won't last the full school year. Especially once Unito Mendez orders the Latin Diablos to break into her car. That's tradition for every new teacher, black or white. Mrs. Walton will be here and gone within a season, here to feed us with possibility, blinded by her hope to make a difference. And before the school year ends, she'll bounce. But I'm used to that. I give her till Christmas. Tell me, she says, checking out the books that I've done a poor job of hiding. What do you want to do with your life? My eyes rise up to the ceiling and stay there, glued to the dried-up wet tissue bombs hanging on for dear life. Lady, I don't feel like hearing one of those Save Our Black Youth speeches. That's what I want to say to her, but I know that sass talk will get me sent to the principal's office. And the last thing I need is Daddy coming up in here. Me and him got enough problems. I hesitate before I speak, trying to think of what she'd want to hear come out of my mouth. Say I want to end world hunger or find world peace? Teachers like that kind of talk. Plus, it seems like a safe enough answer to make her leave me alone until the bell rings. And then no one would have to know the real me I want to be. Nessie wants to be Miss America one day, spills out of Tanisha's mouth before I have a chance to lie. And she can sing. And suddenly, I feel naked. Like straight up covered in layers upon layers of fat, and the whole class is looking at me like a tub of lard, naked. Tanisha turns around and flashes me a cheesy smile like she done said something good. My lips turn upward in a weak smile, but what I really want to do is smack her one good time upside the head. Sometimes I think Tanisha ain't too bright upstairs, because if she were, she would remember that my Miss America dreams are private, for no one else to know about and make fun of, especially Chris Dumont.
Miss America!
Yeah, right! Curtis yells with a toothy grin. Of course, all his homeboys laugh. I knew that was coming.
Man, please! Real black people don't win Miss America. That's for them high yellow girls and white girls with light hair, light eyes, and little bodies. He shouts. And last time I checked, your Tarberry self ain't got none of that!
Curtis got a lot of nerve with his busted behind teeth. The top row is doubled, yes, doubled, as in there are two complete rows of teeth. That probably solves the mystery of the missing ones on the bottom. Calm down now, everyone, Mrs. Walton squeals, but it falls on deaf ears. Not stopping there, Curtis stands up with his fake behind wannabe gangster rapper self and spits out a rhyme.
Vanessa, Vanessa is whack, whack, cause Vanessa, Vanessa's too black, black.
The whole class starts dying. Bust a gut hunched over, bladder holding, laughing. My skin grows too tight for my body. It wants to split open and empty everything inside out, but I ain't letting them see me like that. A knot the size of a baseball bulges in my throat, and here comes Tanisha turning around, looking at me with those sad hazel eyes, mouthing, I'm sorry. Now would be a good time for the floor to open up and swallow me whole. I'm not playing with you guys. Settle down now, Mrs. Walton calls out, flailing her little arms like a helpless newborn bird. But her voice barely rises over the rumblings of the other students.
She too dark!
Don't she know she too fat to be in a beauty pageant?
Man, that Miss America chick wasn't really black. She was mixed or something.
What talent would Vanessa do for a pageant? Read!
It's like a diss fest up in King Middle School today. I sit at my desk, thinking about watching the pageant, anger boiling up inside me worse than a pot of collard greens on a Sunday afternoon. I might not ever make it to the Miss America stage, but it won't be because stupid Curtis says I can't. I stand abruptly, my notebooks and pencils crashing to the floor. Curtis and his dumb friends laugh harder. Like a bolt of lightning slicing through the clouds, my words jolt them and leave them frozen in their seats.
You can make fun of me all you want, but at least I got all my teeth. Looks like the top row ate the bottom row of yours.
The class is singing, dang, as Curtis sits back in his chair all stupid-like, trying to come up with his next crackback. I'm standing there, towering over his scrawny little behind, wondering where this voice came from. Me, the girl who'd rather chew on her fingernails than talk in class. Me, the girl who just had her dreams put out there only to be made fun of. Me, the girl who just shut down the class clown. Tanisha slaps me a high five like I just won a championship basketball game. But I don't feel like a winner at all. Flames dart out of my cheeks. My all-too-small shirt has risen up yet again and my stomachs are spilling out over my jeans.
You gotta have talent to be in a Miss America pageant, you idiot. And Nessie here got a voice straight from heaven. Believe that, boy.
Tanisha's up out of her seat now, too, her long arms spread wide like eagle wings. The class responds in true chorus fashion, ooh, and someone hollers, she served you, son. The bell rings, leaving Curtis no chance to crack back. The room empties and Tanisha waits for me as I pick up my things off the floor. My whole body hovers there longer than it should. Truth is, ain't much left on the inside. Can't stand up if you ain't got no bones. You know, Vanessa, my daughter and I watch the pageant too. In fact, we watch it every year. A friend of mine volunteers for the Miss New Jersey pageant. She was able to get a few board members to help sponsor a pageant at King Middle this year. They're donating the crown, banner, the works. Fires are going up tomorrow. Maybe you'll consider trying out? I rise up to see a much different face. The crunched folds around Mrs. Walton's eyebrows have softened. Oh, now you want to be nice to me? Now that the circus act is over? I could imagine Mrs. Walton glued to the television. For sure it's a colored one and probably big, too. I shrug my shoulders, looking down at her. In this moment, I'm painfully reminded of how big I am for my age. And I think you're right, Vanessa. You can absolutely go for Miss America in a few years, and why not? You're pretty and smart. Would be nice to actually hear you sing instead of watching you hide behind a book. This is chorus, after all. My cheeks grow warm again, and somewhere deep beneath the layers of black skin, I can feel them blush pink.
Mrs. Walton, Tanisha interrupts, Nessie sings in the church choir. You should come one.
I poke her in the ribs. The last person I'd invite to church is Mrs. Walton. I could just see her sitting among all them black folks catching the Holy Ghost in the pews around her. That woman would stick out like a baby lamb in a field of lions.
Don't listen to Tanisha.
and with that, I grab my big mouth friend and drag her to next period. I know Mrs. Walton's faking it anyway with all that talk. It's part of her job to make girls like me feel like they could be somebody. To pretend like she's my friend when the truth is she'd probably deadbolt her doors if I rang the bell to sell Girl Scout cookies. But still, she did ask me to be in the pageant. And she did call me pretty. As in lovely. As in gorgeous. Not even Daddy calls me that. This part of town. The Sugar Hill Gang is blasting on the corner as Tanisha and I walk home after school. Pop-Pop says this rap stuff ain't nothing but the devil's music. But I kind of dig it. It's like the poetry Darlene and I share. Like air and thunder rumbling and waves crashing, huddled together ready for combat, each one hoping to be the winner. Tanisha's dancing with the beat. She getting down, too. Popping and gyrating her little body in ways that would get me slapped. Daddy would have my hide if he saw me dancing like that in public. I could hear him now.
That's how I lost your mama.
I still have no idea what he means. He never talks about her. Doesn't really let anybody else for that matter, especially Pop-Pop. And she's Pop-Pop's own daughter. Grafton Avenue turns into an open-air theater once the dismissal bell rings. To the left, there's Raheem with his boombox balanced on his shoulder. He's rapping along with Sugar Hill Gang while his homeboys breakdance on pieces of cardboard. They're spinning on the top of their heads and twisting their bodies in all kinds of ways. To the right, the Boricuas are blasting that salsa music. Beat so fast, your hips would fall off if you even try to move it. But somehow, they make it look so good. Hector Lavoe's Mi Gente comes on the radio. And the Boricuas go wild when the trumpet starts. This brings me right back to Puerto Rico, I hear Mrs. Mendez cry out. She owns the bodega on the corner and is the mother of the most popular girl at King Middle, Beatriz Mendez, and Grafton's number one gangbanger, Junito El Diablo Mendez. Mrs. Mendez is always dressed to the nines, and every guy in the neighborhood gets all spit-mouthed when they see her. The two drastically different music styles fight to the last note, and in the mix of it all, the people of my hood are hustling. Hustling to catch the bus downtown to pick up a fresh new pair of Adidas. Hustling to get to their jobs. Seems like everybody who does have a job works at the auto parts factory on the corner of Broad and Market. That's where Daddy makes cars for other people while he can't even afford one for himself. And some folks just plain hustle. Hustle anything. Dope. Reefer. Whatever it takes to pay the bills. Once we pass the bodega, Grandmaster Flash pours in through the speakers. The lyrics to his song, The Message, are so true. Where I live is a real live jungle, full of wildness in the people, in the land, in the air. And I often wonder if I'll ever get out of here. Escape the drugs and the dark cloud that hovers over Grafton. Break free of the skin-seeping smell of people who are more than happy to be trapped here. Maybe go live someplace where there are real sunflowers and the kind of real sunshine that Toni Morrison talks about. That's my song, girl! Tanisha screams, and she breaks out into a pop and lock when the second verse comes on. She tickles me in my ribs. I can't help but laugh. The boys on the corner look at her with needy eyes. None of them look at me like that. Come on, Nessie! You know you want to dance! I hope you ain't still tripping over what that fool Curtis said. Are you mad at me for saying the stuff about Miss America? Man, forget Curtis. I smile weakly, adding to my lie. And no, it's cool. I ain't mad. On the outside, my game face is serious, like unbroken concrete. But on the inside, I got a case of twinges in my heart and waves in the deepest pit of my stomach. When Tanisha walks through the door of her apartment, her mother will be there waiting for her, waiting to hear about her day at school. In a perfect world, I'd have a mom to talk to. I'd run inside my building, past the pissy-smelling elevator, and dart up to the 8th floor. I'd swing open the door, huffing and puffing, and yell, Mama, you wouldn't believe what Curtis said today in chorus. And while I'm telling her the story, I'm popping my neck and snapping my fingers. Mama would throw in a few, oh, no, he didn't, lines. She'd give me a few crackbacks for the next time I faced his braided teeth self, and I'd be ready for him. We'd laugh and slap high fives like we'd been homegirls forever. Then she'd make my favorite dinner. Fried chicken, cornbread with honey, macaroni, and cheese with 5 different cheeses because all real moms know how to make it like that. And collard greens to top it off. After dinner, I'd help her wash the dishes. She'd listen to my poetry, and we'd paint each other's nails and watch Jeopardy before going to bed. She would tuck me in and kiss my forehead. She'd crack my window so I could feel the crisp Newark air. I'd drift off into a deep sleep under the hypnotizing spell of rap beats and tropical salsa rhythms. But that world's not real. This one is. The world where I part ways with Tanisha before the sun goes down in Newark. Because we both know the freaks come out at night. Tanisha makes her way to the D building at the bottom of the hill of the projects, where she has a mom and a dad waiting for her. And I turn a sharp left down the dank alley toward the A building, alone. And instead of giving myself a heart attack by running up all those stairs, I force myself into the pissy, stanking elevator, where Daquan the dope fiend is in the corner having a conversation with his imaginary friend. The elevator moves like molasses, chug-a-lugging its way to the 8th floor. I walk in the house to see Pop-Up passed out on the couch, his empty whiskey cup tipped over on the floor, a newspaper at his feet, and the Bible propped up on his chest. It's funny how drunks and druggies can be the smartest, most religious people you'll ever know. Pop-Up's good leg is propped up on the couch while his World War II one dangles off the edge. His prosthetic is on the floor, a reminder of all he lost while he fought in what he calls the white man's war to conquer the world. The news is playing. Even with fall technically here, we're in for a hot one tomorrow. Temperatures will be in the mid-70s. In the background, I hear TJ in his room humming some Patti LaBelle. That boy knows he can hit those high notes. Sometimes I wonder what he's dreaming about when he's singing behind those closed doors. Is he dreaming about his daddy? The one who never stayed around long enough to even give him his last name. Is he missing his mama too? The one who moved down south last year with no explanation? Just left a prayerful note to my father begging him to take care of TJ. Help him grow into the type of man the family can be proud of. I walk past Daddy's always locked bedroom door where it seems he seals away love and good memories and into my own room filled with posters and newspaper clippings of Vanessa Williams taped from wall to wall. Behind my closed door, I stare at an image of the type of beauty I long to be. Vanessa and Mama look one and the same. Honey-dipped, vanilla-coated, perfect in every way. I sink into my bed and pull out I Know Why the Cage Bird Sings. Sometimes I wish I could read with my eyes closed. Maya Angelou's words almost fly off the page and into my mind. Her own cage bird sings a song written in the key of fear. But still in the midst of the unknown, she has hopes and dreams, like me. I long for things, lots of things. Like for Daddy to walk into my room right now with a smile and an embrace. I long for him to do the things that normal dads do. Take me shopping. Go for walks in Branch Brook Park. Stop and play a game of Uno underneath the cherry blossom trees. Outside my window, the moon shines in the distance. It's starting to rise as the sun makes its way to some other part of the world to bring smiles onto other people's faces. And even though I know it will return again, I can't help but wonder if the sun will ever truly shine on this part of town. September 22nd, 1983. This dang flyer! Audition for the first annual Miss King Middle School pageant. When? Friday, September 30th, 1983. Time, 3 p.m. Location, King Middle School Auditorium. What to bring? A pair of heels to model in, a 2-minute talent to perform. Overview, 12 finalists will be selected. Finalists will participate in after-school rehearsals leading up to our final pageant on Saturday, December 10, 1983. Segments of competition include talent, formal wear, onstage interview, and academic achievement. Each segment is worth 25%. Prizes: crown, banner, trophy, and $250 cash award. And that's that. Mrs. Walton's been posting these doggone flyers everywhere in the school. Bright yellow hawking me in the cafeteria, the hallways, even the locker rooms. I can't even get dressed for gym without these dang flyers breathing down my neck. Part of me wants to dare myself to take a chance. The other part runs screaming worse than a 4-year-old begging her mama to chase the boogeyman out of the closet and off to a place where bad dreams don't exist. The King Middle girls are excited about Mrs. Walton's pageant. Personally, I've been dodging that woman like a contagious disease ever since that circus show in class. I can't sit through a replay of my showdown with Curtis, but a small piece of me hopes that she'll shake some good sense into me and make me try out. Tell me, I'm just as good as any other girl at King Middle. On the flip side, I'm praying that she'll do what all the other teachers do. Ignore me and give me an A because I'm one of the very few who even bother to do homework. When I get to sixth period, I see Mrs. Walton has made some big changes in the room. The cave-like walls have been painted a bright blue color. The tissue bombs are still stuck to the ceiling, but I guess she couldn't reach up that far. Posters of musicians are hung all around the room. Ella Fitzgerald, Beethoven, Bob Marley, the Beatles, Marian Anderson. The chairs are gone. All that remain are the piano bench, and a brand new Mrs. Walton. In this room, we will sing, Mrs. Walton announces sternly. There will be no rap battles, no copying off your friend's homework for your next class, and no reading. She turns an icy glare toward me. Unless we are reading music. In this class, we will learn. Am I understood? Everybody's whispering. I hear, Mrs. Walton's grew some balls. And, she ain't playing around with us no more, among other things. Am I understood, class? She raises her voice, her frame growing 10 feet tall. Yes, Mrs. Walton, we say in perfect unison. She starts playing scales like she's possessed. The booming sound causes us all to stand at attention, and we begin to sing up and down the scales. I sing along softly. The voices around me are a mess, some nasal, some off key, and both are drowning out those of us who could possibly be on key like me. Curtis Dumont. She calls on Mr. Broken Train Track Teeth, who is still playing around in the back of the class. Sing the scale, alone. The class starts to giggle. I can't help but laugh, too. Mrs. Walton taps an F and nods for him to start there. Do, re, mi. His voice cracks into a high operatic pitch before he can even get to the next note. Once again, everybody's laughing, but I'm intrigued. The boy with the deep speaking voice actually sings like a girl. And even though I'd never tell him this, Curtis sounded all right. Mrs. Walton's lips tighten as she shouts, "In this class, there will be no more insults. You are all capable of singing well. Curtis, you have a lovely, effeminate tone to your voice. You are an alto and will stand in the middle row." I so want to add, "With the girls." Curtis sinks his chest in a bit and makes his way to the middle row, away from his brassy-voiced friends in the tenor section. "Vanessa, your turn," Mrs. Walton calls. I sigh, but not loud enough for Mrs. Walton to hear. My waistband tightens to the point where I feel like I'm gonna bust a button on my pants. That's if I actually had buttons. Most have been replaced with safety pins. Maybe if I breathe deep, one of the pins will bust open and prick me in the stomach so I can go to the nurse. I step forward, slow as can be. Everyone's looking at me and I swear I want to throw up. It's not like this at church. There I'm free, whole. Here, I'm only half a person, judged by the way I look, the way I talk, the clothes I wear. Mrs. Walton begins to play the scales again. This time she says, in the key of G. I suck in a large breath and pray to baby Jesus. Please sound good. Please sound good. My eyes close tight as my voice climbs the scale, reaching the high G like it's nothing. I hold the last note way past the point of Mrs. Walton's piano pedal. When I have released all the oxygen I can, I fade the note out and open my eyes. Everyone's staring at me. Excellent job, Vanessa! Tanisha was right the other day. You can sing. What a lovely soprano voice you have. Make your way to the front row. Tanisha starts clapping hard, adding a little squeal and a jump, but nobody else joins her. Just a few teeth-sucking sounds and a couple of whispers. She thinks she all that. My insides cave in, shoulders collapsing into my chest. Beatrice Mendez, decked out in red Reeboks, red earrings, and red lip gloss, rolls her eyes at me. I lower my head, my spirit deflating by the second. My fingers start to shake as I take my place in the front row next to her. I put my imaginary blinders on and don't even look her way. Mrs. Walton makes everyone sing like this until the bell rings. Vanessa, please remain in class for just a minute. I will write you a late pass for next period, Mrs. Walton says. When the room clears, Mrs. Walton's eyes get all wide and I know what's coming. Remember the other day when I told you I have a friend sponsoring the school pageant? I nod my head slowly, but don't say anything. You are trying out for Miss King Middle, right? I think you'd be great. She pulls out the yellow flyer from her folder, laying it on top of the piano. I look at it for a second, and when I lift my eyes, Mrs. Walton is straight cheesing. My stomach is making gurgling noises, and I'm standing there praying that she doesn't hear them. Isn't this just wonderful? Especially with all the buzz about Vanessa Williams. This'll be perfect practice for when you eventually try out for Miss America. That's what being in a pageant is all about, you know. Not just being pretty. It's about talent and being a good student. And you are all that. You said you wanted to be Miss America, Vanessa, she says. So here you go. This ain't, I say, but then I see Mrs. Walton raise an eyebrow. I mean, this isn't the Miss America pageant. Note to self, no street talk around the white lady.
No, it's not, but it's a step. How do you think those women in the real Miss America pageant got their start? By doing something small and working their way up. You can do this. You should do this, she says, shoving the flyer into my hand. I bite the inside of my lip to the point where it could bleed any second. Then I flash back to when I watched the pageant. Sure, I pictured myself on that television screen wearing a bomb fancy dress, tearing up the stage with some grand powerhouse song, and in the end having the crown placed on my head. But that wasn't the girl I pictured on the outside. That girl was a lighter, skinnier, prettier version of me. And that was fantasy. If I did this, I'd have to be on stage, the real me, in front of the entire school. Oh, heck nah. I know what you're thinking, Mrs. Walton breaks my train of thought. I'm thinking, why in the world do you care so much? I admit. Mrs. Walton swallows hard and clutches her pearls like, how dare you ask me that?
Let's just say that at one point in my life, I too wanted to be in the Miss America pageant. Only I didn't have an opportunity like this.
I take one look at that blonde hair, those blue eyes, and throw my head back laughing toward the tissue bomb sky. This lady is on something.
You're laughing, but it's true. Times were tough for me and my family back then. I didn't have anyone in my corner to help me toward that dream. I wasn't as smart as you, or as well-read and well-spoken. Vanessa, it's 1983 and this country has finally crowned a black Miss America. Sky's the limit for you. My laughter cuts short.
You're wondering how you're going to prepare for all of this, right?
Well, yeah, sort of, I respond.
I can help you with everything, especially your talent. We can practice in my classroom after school twice a week, and you don't need any help in the academic achievement portion. I looked at your files. High honor roll every marking period since kindergarten? Mrs. Walton is talking in one long-winded breath and doesn't even come up for air. We can also practice for the onstage interview, which shouldn't be so bad given how much you read. And while I'd love to help you pick out a dress for formal wear, I'm sure your mom and dad will want to...
Listen, Mrs. Walton, I cut her off. Thank you for thinking of me, but I can't do this pageant. What I really want to say is Mama ain't around and Daddy don't have time for me anyway. So what's the point? But my words turn into movement. Next thing I know, my feet are pushing me down the hall. My eyes are stinging. Every single organ in my body is losing electricity. My hands are crumpling up the flyer and throwing it in the trash. Ain't gonna be no pageant. Not for me, at least. I got better things to do with my time anyway. And that's that.
September 23rd, 1983. The beginning of the end. Once upon a time, there lived a little girl with a mom and a dad and sunshine and love. Then one day, the mom ran far, far away. The dad turned into the big bad wolf, and the little girl never saw the sun again. The end. Dear Darlene, you know we ain't never been into fairy tales anyway. Nessie.
Letting go.
Nessie, get up! You're gonna be late for choir practice!
The stank of Pop-Pop's whiskey-tainted breath burns my nose. The rest of him seems fine. His eyes are clear, not glassy like when he drinks at night. Beneath the faint layer of tart whiskey, I can smell Shield soap, so he must have showered already. He's always good on the weekends because, according to him, the good Lord's looking at him when he walks through the church doors come Sunday.
It's the weekend, thank God. No school and no dodging Mrs. Walton. All I got is church choir rehearsal today and Sunday service tomorrow.
In the background, the news is playing, and the sizzle of something cooking in the kitchen perfumes the entire house. The gritty, bacony, syrupy scent drifts into my room, and I soon forget about the drunken cloud that surrounds Pop-Pop. What time is it? I ask, wiping the sleep out of my eyes.
Almost 11, he says.
I can't believe I slept this late. I blame that on Mama for seeping into my head and ruining what could have been a perfect night's sleep. Tired of dreams keeping me awake at night.
Your teacher called me this morning, asking to speak to your mama.
My throat gets real tight. No teachers have ever called the house.
What teacher? I ask slowly.
Lady named Mrs. Walton. Nessie, you didn't tell me you were singing in the school chorus. Well, I'll be.
Pop-Up slaps his good leg. It wiggles while the World War II one stands motionless. She asked for Mama? What did you say? My voice has elevated 2 octaves.
I told her the truth.
I stopped breathing for a second. Oh, Lord, here it comes.
That she wasn't here.
He finishes, and his forehead double creases. It is the truth. She isn't here. I don't know where she is, or if she's even alive for that matter.
Listen here, Nessie. I know you got a lot of questions and things on your mind, but it's best that you forget about your mama for now. All you need to know is that she loves you. One day when the time is right, I'm sure your daddy will explain everything. Plus, you got all the love you need right here.
Pop-Pop spreads out his arms real wide. But where is she? The question whirls all through my head. It's the same one I've asked him for years, but all I'm ever met with are deaf ears and sealed lips. He hugs me tight, and I breathe in his whiskey-fading, soapy-scented aroma. I do have love here with him and TJ, and I guess with Daddy.
I breathe a sigh of relief and rise up to get ready for choir practice. We're singing Going Up Yonder. TJ's singing lead. He's gonna tear the house down come Sunday morning. If only I had his courage to get out in front of an audience like that.
She done told me about that pageant, Nessie,
Pop-Pop says, limping to the door. Pop-Pop, he cuts me off.
Now look at here. I know you don't want to do it because you figure your mama ain't around to help you. Your mama would be proud. Heck, I am. I tell you one thing. Doing that pageant would be like second nature to you.
I don't want to, Pop-Pop. And how you figure?
Just trust me. I think you should try out. Now, I know your daddy won't approve, but let me deal with him. You got all the help you need right here. And that teacher who called here this morning seemed to want to help you. Now, you march your pretty self into that audition next week.
Pop-Pop brushes his hand across my face. I know that in his eyes, I am pretty. And not just the pretty for a dark-skinned girl comments I sometimes get from folks at church. TJ comes walking down the hall, cheesing so hard his mouth takes up his entire face. All I see are lips, teeth, and that big old afro.
I heard all about the pageant, Nessie, and you might as well do it.
Yeah, whatever. I'll think about it.
I can make all your clothes. I gotta design something for my final grade anyway. Come on, do it for me,
TJ begs. Pop-Pop rolls his eyes. He doesn't dig TJ's fashion designer dreams too tough, but he knows he has no say. TJ is a Martin. Daddy's nephew, daddy's problem.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.